And we are here for the third of three incredible lectures that Nachliel Sullivan has been running for us. The feedback has been so strong and so good. And Nachliel, without wanting to embarrass you publicly, because there's already 50, but there's more than 50 people on this, and we're only 3 minutes past 12. I've been getting a slew of emails saying, why is this only a three-part series? This could be a whole year series. So let me speak to Nachliel. I see many of you are nodding. What a wonderful thing. I'm going to speak to Nachliel, and we're going to find out if we can see his face once more, because I too have enjoyed his classes immensely. They've gotten better as the weeks have gone on. And without any further ado, I'm going to introduce you to what is already a familiar face for the third of our three-part lecture series of ancient historical experiences and the Jewish people's interaction with ancient civilizations. Today's class is Rome. And so I will hand over now to Nachliel Sullivan, who I have just made a co-host.
Fine, let me go to
and I will be listening and participating along with you. Thank you, everybody.
Thank you. Thank you very much, Rabbi. And it's very exciting to see everyone again. So welcome. Let me just quickly share my screen. Just a moment. Okay. And there we go. Okay. So our subject today is Rome. Our subject today is Rome, and it's the Foundations of Our Identity series, part three. And the reason I chose Rome is because our interaction with the Roman Empire is a very profound one, both historically and philosophically. Historically, the destruction of the Second Temple, the Bar Kokhba revolt, the Roman Empire absorbing Christianity, which is, you can say, the wayward son of Judaism, becoming the religion of the empire. And that leads to where we are today, where the Western world is very much, on the one hand, like we saw last week, influenced by Greece, by the Greek philosophy, the Greek culture. But the other part that comprises Western society is what we call Judeo-Christian values. In other words, the ideas that come from our tradition and the Tanakh as they were absorbed and changed by Christianity and brought to the world. Concepts such as the world is going in a particular direction and there's a culmination. Ten Commandments is such a common idea. And values that we bring with us. So the West has been formed really by the connection of Athens and Jerusalem, as I mentioned last week, but the aspect of Jerusalem which comes forward to the world, I would say that the Roman Empire plays a very active part in that. As well as in Western society, Rome is the basis of many concepts in the foundation, the institution, for example, of the United States. It has to do with the Senate, the veto, House of Representatives, many other ideas, but I don't want to get distracted. So when we're speaking about Rome, I would like to go into a tour which shows us a few very interesting things. I'm going to start actually with something which was found underneath my parents' home, which is this picture. This is a picture of my hand, see? I'm holding in my hand in this picture a piece of pinched clay, which is what's called ner, candle. We're almost at Hanukkah, and we talk about nerot. A ner in biblical times and in the Second Temple period was not a string which was coated in paraffin and wax, but rather it was an oil, a clay, a vessel which held oil. And this was found underneath my parents' house in the old city of Jerusalem, and it is filled with ashes, which are from the destruction of the Second Temple period Jerusalem by the Romans. This is underneath my parents' house when we expanded our storage room, or bomb shelter, what it's actually supposed to be. And this is just an example of the history that I've just been fortunate to absorb walking down the streets of my childhood neighborhood. Another thing which we found is these coins, which is fun to look at because look carefully and you may notice that it looks like a Magen David, right? Like a Star of David. But in fact, this is a Muslim coin, which has no connection to Judaism. And the shape of the Magen David is a geometric shape. It's a geometric shape at the time. So the Muslims used a lot of geometric shapes instead of pictures, which the Romans and the Byzantine Empire, they used pictures. So that's kind of an interesting thing. Now, what I'd like to do is to take us on our virtual tour to this place. So let's go to the Old City. So the Old City of Jerusalem, not a 15-minute drive from where I'm sitting right now in Baca. And the Old City of Jerusalem has become known to the world as the Holy Land as a result of its destruction. It's being taken over by the Roman Empire, which became the Byzantine Empire, which then said, well, Israel is the land of the Bible. And once they've absorbed that, it became the Holy Land. So that's a fun fact that that's through the Christian Byzantine Roman Empire. But this is the Old City of Jerusalem. Here's an aerial view. Let's make it the way we're used to looking at it, facing north. So there's the Temple Mount. And before we jump in, I just want to point out that the walls that we see today, which are this road surrounding them roughly, the walls that we see today are only about 500 years old. Yeah, these walls are about 500 years old, built by the Ottoman Emperor Suleiman the Magnificent. And they are overlapping some of the Second Temple period walls, which are much wider. It's a much wider area. And we're going to visit that soon. Okay. So this is, first of all, where our story really begins with the Old City of Jerusalem, because the reason for our clash with the Roman Empire is because of the Roman takeover of the land of Israel, which is at the end of the Hasmonean period. The last Hasmonean king is basically killed by King Herod. And after that, it's pretty much the Roman Empire for the next few hundred years. So the Roman Empire takes control of Jerusalem and ends up destroying the Second Temple, ends up finally banning Jews from living in Jerusalem, the subsequent revolt known as the Bar Kokhba revolt, which was about almost 70 years later. So Jerusalem has been heavily impacted by the Romans. And we're going to talk about how that connects to modern Israel, the emblem of the state of Israel, and all kinds of other interesting things that we'll see soon. Now, when we want to talk about the Romans and their impact on the way Jerusalem looks, we need to see a few important things. I'm going to start with the Temple Mount. So what we see in front of us, I'm going to look up so you can sort of get an idea. This is the Western Wall, and that is the southern corner of the Western Wall. You come into the Old City, you come into the Kotel, the Western Wall, from the parking, from the road, from the street, and you are entering via the Dung Gate, as it is called. Shar HaShpot, it's the lowest gate in the Old City, which where all the junk would sort of be washed down there. It's the sewage exit for the Old City. And the great gate was widely expanded later on, but about 100 years ago, it was a very narrow gate. So this is the corner. And the stones that you're seeing on the floor and the tiles are all Herodian. Herodian meaning the Romans. The Roman Empire appointed Herod as the king of the Jews in Judea, and he builds the Second Temple. What we see here is a few interesting things. First of all, the incredibly massive wall built by King Herod. But on top of that, we also have an archway, which has been largely destroyed. It's known as Robinson's Arch because Sir Robinson discovered it. And it's one of two arches that are visible today, which were supporting a staircase going up to the western side of the Temple Mount when the temple was built 2,000 years ago. This is part of the arch. If you're familiar with the men's section in the western wall, the main section, that is where the other arch is. It's all underneath an arch. So that's called Wilson's Arch, based on Wilson, who discovered it, a British explorer, I think. And on the floor itself was shattered by these massive stones, which just collapsed during the burning of the temple and even broke holes into the floor where you can go down into the drainage system. And we found some things there where the Josephus in the Jewish Wars writes that the Jewish rebels were hiding there. And very often they actually swallowed golden coins, their treasure, with them so that they can escape and then, collect them when they use the restroom. Well, the Romans caught on to that. They caught them. They would cut open their gut and find the coin. So it was pretty tragic, the stories that are told about what happened in this sewage system. But that's all below this. It looks like a lot of lintels on top of shops, but this is actually not only lintels, but there's a water system on top of it, providing flowing, running water for the shops in Jerusalem at the foot of the Temple Mount. So we're talking about an advanced society for those days. The Romans brought in engineering, water systems, public bathhouses, and all that stuff. We'll see some of the things they've done a little bit later. Now, what I want to show you is another site here in the Old City, which is from the same period, the late Second Temple period, known as the Herodian period, when King Herod was king and his successors were kings until the destruction. And that is called the Herodian Quarter. Let's jump, hold on, and go. So the Herodian Quarter is underneath a building known today as Yeshivat HaKotel, the yeshiva, which began as a bunch of people after the Six-Day War. They came to Jerusalem and they said that Rav Hadari came and said that the place is in ruins, we need to fortify the Torah study. And he bought a bunch of guys together and they studied right there, and it ended up becoming a yeshiva. Not before, of course, they excavated to build the foundations, and that's where they found these houses, which are in a museum underneath the yeshiva. So we've now jumped underground to what was floor level in the time of the Second Temple. And these are all vessels of all sorts, stoneware, pottery. There's even this, if you look at that at the end, there's a special place for putting your feet to soak your feet, all kinds of interesting things going on here. Big plates, serving dishes, and on and on. And we're going to look at the floor, but I want you to first see that even though there's a building on top, there's big stone jugs there for perhaps for wine and other things. There's many different rooms. Let's jump to another room so you get a better idea. We're inside one of the rooms. Let's look around. We're looking into a room which has stairs going into it and a plastered wall. Now, what could that possibly be inside somebody's house? These are houses, as far as we know, of Kohanim, who were priests who were serving in the Beit HaMikdash, which is across the street. We are talking about the most expensive real estate. This is the Upper West Side of Jerusalem. We're west of the Temple Mount. And these are houses which have several rooms and multiple stories. And in each house, several of these rooms, which have stairs going in, and they're covered with plaster to be able to store water. This, ladies and gentlemen, is a mikvah, a ritual bath. Some of these houses had seven ritual baths within them. Now think of the wealth that we are talking about. Why would I have to go across the street and coordinate with whenever the mikveh is open when I can have one in every room of the house? One for small dishes, one for us, one for the boys, one for the girls, one for furniture. I mean, This is a luxurious lifestyle, right? These are very big houses. Now, Google Earth doesn't allow us to see that much here. We'll see more in the museum, but this is, look carefully and you'll see small stones on a carpet. This is called a mosaic carpet. This is a typical Roman period decoration for floors. It's a mosaic, very basic, but it's a mosaic. This tells us this was a wealthy home. The houses of the Kohanim, very, very rich people, influential people. We know about them from historic sources as well as people who, I mean, even if you go into, I don't need to mention the famous stories which are known from the New Testament of, you know, the Kohanim are being considered corrupt and Jesus goes, turns over the table. I mean, these are things that are known worldwide, the story of the priests being very wealthy. But in our sources alone, we know that the Kohanim were very influential and some of them were very corrupt. They were bought off by the authorities. They paid the authorities for tax collecting power and so on and so forth. But these are houses of priests. We see them, we find them. So you're just seeing a very large home. Let's see what they found inside these homes inside the Israel Museum. So Israel Museum, I was just there a few hours ago today guiding a tour. And the Israel Museum has the crown jewels of Israel's archaeology. It has the best stuff. And we're right across the street from the Knesset right here. And this is basically Capitol Hill. What you're seeing here is the rebuilding of the National Library. It looks a lot better since this satellite picture was taken. It's almost open to the public. There's a stadium, all the good stuff. Let's go into the section of the museum, which has what we found in the Herodian Quarter and the Temple Mount. So in the Israel Museum, we have a model of the Second Temple. I don't remember if we did this last week. We probably did not. This model used to be in a hotel called the Holy Land Hotel. You may be familiar with it. It was moved here a few decades ago into the Israel Museum, but people still call it the Holy Land model because it's stuck. And this is a model built by the classicist. His name is Professor Michael Aviona. He was an expert on the subject of classic Jewish history, the Greek period, the Roman period, and he designed this model using available textual sources, as well as what was known archaeologically at the time. Some of it is inaccurate. He actually the legend goes that he would tell his students when he would take them to the model, I want you to find the mistakes. And you really got to know your history and your archaeology to know the mistakes and what they assume is the model of the Second Temple period. So here's the Second Temple. We are looking at this model from the east, from the Mount of Olives, looking at it. The western wall is on the other side. And this is a fortress which was built by King Herod. King Herod built, who lived, he ruled from the year 37 to 4 BCE. So let's just say 2,040 years ago. All right, let's make it easy for everyone. 2,040 years ago till about 2,000 years ago. King Herod rules, he builds the Antonia Fortress. The reason he builds it is to keep control of the Temple Mount. So an example of the control is the high priest, the Kohen Gadol, would have to remove his garments at the end of the day and deposit them in the fortress for safekeeping. And that way we maintain control. During the Great Revolt, this was one of the strongholds of the Roman army, which were taken over by the rebels, the Jews, at very high cost, and were a turning point in the battle when we were able to control the fortress. But eventually that was destroyed as well. Let me show you another part. I'm going to walk around the model. We're looking now from the south up at the southern wall. We were just looking at the remains of Robinson's Arch. And right here in the picture, highlight that. In the picture, we see a reconstruction of the arch itself with the stairway going up. This little monument to the bottom right is the shrine of the prophetess Huldah from the end of the First Temple period. So that for that reason, the gates here are known as the Huldah gates, Sha'arei Huldah. Because this is where tradition has it that she was buried. But this is just a little bit of the environment of the Second Temple of Jerusalem. And another thing we'll see in a bit is that this edifice on the west, on the south, which today people go to for bar mitzvahs, it's much quieter than the buzzing Western Wall on Monday and Thursday bar mitzvah day. It's much nicer. And this area is where King Agrippa, Agrippa II, who was one of the descendants of Herod, and he was a half Jewish king, so to speak, on behalf of the Romans. He tried to calm down the rebellion, but nobody listened to him, and the rebellion started. This is where it took place. And we'll see some things that were found from there. So this is just a really just a little taste of Jerusalem in the Herodian and Roman period. I'll show you one more thing. We're just looking around. See that? See all the construction around us. But second. Okay. Here we go. This, we're looking now at the Western Wall. This is this little section over here that we pray at today. This is the Western Wall. Okay. We were just looking at this southwestern corner. And there's a small section over here known as the Kotel HaKatan, the small Kotel, because amidst all the buildings that were added on top of it in the Muslim period to sort of cover it up, there's a small area where you can actually pray at the Western Wall, just a smaller section of it, known as the Kotel HaKatan. That's something that's, I thought that would be nice to know, as well as the fact that when we are praying at the Western Wall, we are looking at the back of the temple itself, which was really with its main entrance in the east, facing west. So we are, if you're in North America, you'll usually have a sign, a poster, a picture that says Mizrach, right? The east, because you're facing Yerushalayim. But if you're in Yemen, you're facing north. If you're in Turkey, you're facing south. If you're in Kazakhstan, you're facing west. So Mizrach is all relative. It's Europe and the United States. Just pointing that out. Okay. America, not the United States. My bad. Now let's go inside. Oh, one last thing. These towers that you're looking at over here, also built by King Herod, known as Miriam and Patzael, are what is today the Tower of David. Not built by King David. Pay no attention to the man behind the curtain. That's a mistake. It's a crusader mistake. They came to Jerusalem, saw a tower, learned in Bible school that King David ruled Jerusalem. Here's a tower. This is Jerusalem. Tower of David. It's nothing to do with it. So the Tower of David is basically the remains of a Herodian fortress, which was then rebuilt by the crusaders and then the Muslims, et cetera, et cetera. Let's jump into the museum. Okay, now this is really amazing. We are inside the Roman galleries in the Israel Museum. And unlike the Roman galleries from any other museum in the world, which has a lot of Roman stuff from Rome or the Roman Empire, we're looking at things from Israel. Let me just give you a few, a taste of a few little things. Second. This is a mosaic from the Herodian Quarter, which we just saw. With pomegranates, it's really nice, and a stone table, stoneware, stone vessels, which is important because stoneware has a connection to ritual purity and impurity, to Mayan Tahara, because stoneware as something which is natural does not absorb impurity, does not absorb Tum'ah, which means that you can use it as a Kohen who's involved in eating of foods and drinks which have sanctity without needing to worry too much about what happens to your dishes. It's like daily life back in the day when you were thinking about those things. Today, people worry more like, is the kashrut like star K, triangle K, circle K, OU, this, that? You know, there was like, well, did it touch a lizard when you were eating something while you were wet, or somebody else who was in contact with someone who passed away and they touched my dishes and now I have to break them. Ah, but it's stone. I don't have to break them. That's kind of the lifestyle. So ritual bathhouses is like a little glimpse into the world of that time. But here are several very important pieces. And since this picture has been taken, more has been added to here. But This is in a nutshell. In the back is a picture of the Temple Mount. You should be able to see it. With the reconstructed gates, that's Robinson's Gate, that's Wilson's Gate in the back. And the stone in the back, this Ionian capital, which is more like a Doric capital, in the back is, Ionian capital, is from the temple itself, where King Agrippa stood to tell people off from trying to rebel against the Romans. This is from the building. And inside it here is a piece of stone. I can talk about all the other things, but I'd really like to keep it focused. This piece of stone is from the southwestern corner of the temple wall, which is in the picture right behind us. And I want to show you what it says. And that's the really fascinating part. So I'm going to jump back to our slide. And this is the stone, okay? Now look carefully. You should be able to identify individual Hebrew letters, okay? So I'm gonna separate out for you so you can see the three words. So this is it. We have Lebet, Hatekiah, and then Lamed Hey, and a letter which can be a Chaf, it can be a Bet. It's not so clear what it is. I'm going to now show it to you in a much cleaner form. That should make it a little bit easier. Here we go. And thank you for PowerPoint. Here we go. So these are the two suggested reconstructions, and I'll explain what they mean. Lebet HaTkiah, Tkiah, like on Rosh Hashanah, Tkiah. So Tkiah is blowing the trumpets, or the shofar, which is part of the active temple service. There was a station on the top of the temple where a Kohen or a Levite or a priest would stand, and he would blow the trumpet at different opportune moments, whether it's to announce the coming in of Shabbat, maybe it's to tell people to stop working in the field and come home, maybe it's a festival, whatever it is, that's part of the temple in operation. The missing part is either lehachriz, which means to announce, or lehavdil, which means to differentiate, and which meaning between like Havdalah, as we say, between Kodesh Lechol. So the picture, this is the picture on the right, showing you what it would have looked like more or less. And it was found on the top, it fell down and was carved out and brought to the Israel Museum. And on the left, you might recognize the picture. It's a very iconic picture, except I focused on a part of the picture which nobody pays attention to, because of a selective memory. This is from the Arch of Titus. The Arch of Titus in color. We'll talk about the true colors in the Arch of Titus a little bit later. That was a Yeshiva University project, which was spearheaded by my professor, Stephen Fine. So I'll get to that later. But part of the procession, which was eternalized in the Arch of Titus, is the golden table, the Shulchan, and the two chatzotzot, the two silver trumpets, which are right there being brought in to Rome. So that's kind of a glimpse into just the world of the Second Temple when it was in operation. Now let's go back to our virtual tour, to our location. And I wanna take us from here to talk a little bit more about King Herod. Like, what does it mean, the Herodian period? And what does it mean that Herod is Roman? Like, what exactly did he do? So first thing I'll note is this is right over here. If you'd be there today, you'd see the sarcophagus of King Herod, which was found maybe a 20-minute drive from where I live in Herodion, where he was buried. It was a sarcophagus, but that wasn't here when they filmed this, which was a few years earlier, than like close to 20 years ago, actually. But this is part of a bathhouse from a fortress built by King Herod or renovated by King Herod called Masada. You've definitely heard of Masada. You may have been to Masada. And this is a small segment of a bathhouse. Now, it's nice to see a bathhouse in the museum, but it's a lot more impressive when you see where it was taken from. So hold on to your virtual seatbelts. We're about to jump to the area of Masada near the Dead Sea. Granada. This is the best time of year to visit it virtually because it's getting cold. Look at that. Look at the view before we jump in of Mitsada. Mitsada National Park is, of course, a must-see. It's one of the top 10 sites that people visit when they come to Israel. Mitsada, which was there from the time of the Hasmonean kings, but it was really fortified and turned into what we know it today by King Herod. Now, when you see where Mitsada is, that changes your perspective a little bit on the fact that there was a bathhouse on a hilltop in the desert. A bathhouse on a hilltop on a fortress, which was built to withstand siege, as indeed it did. It had enough water there for 2 or 3 years of siege. And in addition to that, it was also a luxury palace where Herod would invite officials and dignitaries and kings from around the empire and host them in his luxurious house in the Poconos, or, well, in Mitsada. And he even had irrigation there, little bonsai trees that he would grow. I mean, we're talking tiny little trees that were cultivated as gifts for dignitaries. I mean, the stuff that's been found in Mitsada is incredible. When you talk about a person who built, that is King Herod is the one who built. We have a whole outlook here, courtesy of Google Earth. You can actually move around and see some of the buildings. I think we're in the northern area, right? Can move around. It's really incredible to get a view of Mitsada. That's the northern palace. Okay, so here we are. Here's the guy who's filming for us. Thank you so much, Mr. Blankface. We appreciate it. Now, so I'd like to add to continue our tradition from last week, which is using Monty Python to raise a very important question. When we talk about King Herod, we are talking about the Roman Empire. The Roman Empire became present in the land of Israel thanks to King Herod's building operations. So that takes us to this very famous piece, one second, from Monty Python, Life of Brian, and here we go.
They bled us white and fast. They take everything we had, and not just from us. From our fathers, and from our fathers' fathers.
And from our fathers' fathers' fathers.
Yeah.
And from our fathers' 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 fathers.
All right, Stan, don't labor the point. And what have they ever given us in return?
The aqueduct?
What?
The aqueduct.
Oh, yeah, they did give us that. That's true, yeah.
And the sanitation.
Oh, yeah, the sanitation, Reg. Remember what the city used to be like?
Yeah, all right, I'll grant you, the aqueduct and sanitation are two things the Romans had done.
And the roads.
Well, yeah, obviously the roads. I mean, the roads go without saying, don't they? But apart from the sanitation, the aqueduct and the roads...
Irrigation.
Medicine. Education. Yeah, all right, fair enough.
And the wine.
Yeah, that's something we've really missed, Reg, if the Romans left.
Public baths.
And it's safe to walk in the streets at night now, Reg.
Yeah, they certainly know how to keep order. Let's face it, the only ones who could in a place like this.
All right, but apart from the sanitation, the medicine, education, wine, public order, irrigation, roads, a fresh water system and public health, what have the Romans ever done for us?
Brought peace?
Oh, peace! Shut up!
Anyway... So the famous, what have the Romans ever done for us? The person who brought what the Romans have done for us into Israel is King Herod. He's the one who terraformed the land. Let's see another example of something he's done. And speaking of the aqueduct, as mentioned aptly by these Jewish rebels in the movie, let's go to the aqueduct. We're all familiar, I'm sure, with Hana Senesh and her very famous song called Halicha la Kesaria, A Walk to Kesaria. Eli, Eli, shelo yigamer leolam. That's her song, which she sings when she's in Kibbutz Sdot Yam, right over here, where she was walking on the sand, and she sings that very famous song. So this is Kesaria. Now, Kesaria Caesarea, or Kesaria Maritima, built in honor of the Caesar, Augustus, I think it was, who was very friendly with King Herod, he built an aqueduct there. And I want us to see the aqueduct, but first to understand in terms of the location of Caesarea, of Caesarea, that Caesarea was built to rival the greatest docking port in the area, which is here in Tyre, okay, in Lebanon. What King Herod did was he used some brilliant volcanic ash to make a very specific type of concrete, which kind of like epoxy, if you're familiar. It's a kind of putty, which is black and gray. And when you mix them together, they congeal and become as hard as steel. He made this volcanic ash kind of cement and built out of it an aqueduct, a wave breaker, which is something like this, but larger. It collapsed a while ago, but it's a visible underground. And he basically provided security for ships to dock for during the winter, thus bringing in a tremendous amount of business and wealth. And he provided entertainment for all of these merchants who are staying for like half a year at a time on the coast of Judea. So Herod brought in Roman culture and wealth from around the empire and really made Judea a very wealthy country, and finance these incredible building operations, which he did. Now let's see the aqueduct. So the Roman aqueduct, this is from an aerial view. Okay, we'll go down to the ocean in a moment, but the aqueduct was designed to bring in water from faraway places, Nachal Taninim and a few other places, and sometimes at a fraction of a degree's decline to bring the water into the city, and thus to be able to sustain a modern Roman city with sanitation, public bathhouse, nymphaeums, like springs in the middle of the street for beauty. And therefore you can grow the population exponentially because you can provide water for them without being dependent on local water sources. This is one of the important things that the Romans have done for us, and courtesy of King Herod. Let's see what the aqueduct looks like from the street view. Here it is, supported by a system of many arches, and the aqueduct runs on top. This is a very wide aqueduct. There are much larger ones and mostly small, narrower ones. It really depends on where you are, but the Romans laced the country with roads and aqueducts, basically putting Israel on the grid. Putting Israel on the grid. This is the aqueduct. It's been, of course, renovated by Hadrian and other emperors as well, but this is the aqueduct. It's a lot of fun. So that's the first thing. The next thing I want to show you, and that's going to tie us into the conversation about the destruction, and that has to do with gladiators and the Colosseum. It's a lot of fun. This is Beit Guvrin. So let's jump to Beit Guvrin. Here we go. Okay, so Beit Guvrin, but Beit Guvrin is, before I go to Beit Guvrin, this was my segue. In Caesarea itself, forgive me, I forgot that I skipped a step. In Caesarea, there is a theater which is misnamed amphitheater, because we hear theater, so we think, okay, that's a full circle. So ampi must mean half theater, but the truth is amphitheater means a whole theater. This is just a theater, but it's called what it's called. So this is the theater of Caesarea, and this here is the hippodrome, this long horse racing range, which partially collapsed into the ocean. So a new one was built. It's a little bit further off, like so here. This is the new one that was built, this oblong over here. So that's the hippodrome. Now let's go into the theater, and this is going to be our segue to Beit Guvrin. So Caesarea today is, they just call it the Amphi. Everybody knows the Amphi is Caesarea, and they have shows here. I was here last year for a show. It's a great place for concerts. But the truth is that when this was built, it was built by Herod as a place to promulgate Roman culture, which had to do with theater, tragedy, play, and even gladiators. And that's the tragic part, as we'll see in a moment. But this takes us to Beit Guvrin. The story goes that there was a quarrel between Jews and Gentiles in the city of Caesarea. And this is already at a point where the Gentile-Jewish relations in Israel are at a boiling point. But this is where that really led out to the all-out rebellion. It was on a Shabbat in Caesarea. So Caesarea is really where the Great Revolt started, and then it continued and trickled into Jerusalem. Now here's Beit Guvrin. It's not far from Beit Shemesh. It's in the south of Jerusalem. And in Beit Guvrin is a very important Roman city, which has at its center a stadium. But this stadium was used, this is an amphitheater. This stadium was used, and you have these models here to see, for gladiators. We know from our sources, Josephus and others, that after the Romans destroyed Jerusalem and before the procession in Rome even happened, Jewish slaves were already put up for sport to fight against each other or against other gladiators or against wild animals in these very theaters, whether it's Beit Guvrin or it's Caesarea or other ones throughout the area. But this is an area which was used by Romans to entertain themselves. And there's even questions in the Talmud. Can one go and participate in a gladiator show on the Sabbath? Right. And the reason that you can go is because very often it was whether or not the person who was Jewish would be killed for entertainment was based on votes. Everyone would have their thumbs up or thumbs down whether he should live or die. Now, if you may have seen the movie Gladiator. And in that movie, here, let me just switch for a moment. In that movie, we have a second. Skipping. In that movie, we have a scene where everybody is being asked to put their thumbs up or down. And because of modern sentiments, they didn't do it historically accurate, even though most of the movie is very accurate. And here's what I mean. Thumbs down, you would think means life or death, right? That means death. This means life. But in the Roman Empire, it was actually the opposite. This would mean basically kill him. This would mean stick your sword in the ground, don't kill him. So they had to change that for the movie because it's a little bit too much for us to, like, it would be weird. So they had to change that. There's a very famous movie, Gladiators. There's wild animals, entertainment. This is about Marcus Aurelius. It's a whole story. It's a great movie. I watched it twice in theater. But that takes us to the Colosseum. And that's our next stop on the map. The Colosseum in Rome, in the backdrop, was minted on a very special edition coin. You're seeing both sides of that coin. On the one high side, it said there is Aspasianus, etc. This is a coin by Vespasian. There's also a coin like this by Titus, and it's a picture of the Colosseum. But this takes us into a very interesting conversation about who built the Colosseum and how was it financed. And I want it for that story, I'd like to take you to the site of the Colosseum in Rome. So hold on, we're about to jump to Italy. Okay, speaking of the destruction, and here we go. The Colosseum of Rome. The Colosseum of Rome was able to hold, what was it? I think it's 100,000 people. That is I think that my number might be a little bit off, but about 100,000 people, give or take. That is an incredible amount of people. And the Colosseum, of course, now it's all destroyed. But the chambers underneath were barracks for gladiators. They would have wild animals there. And then there's all the bleachers here for people to sit down. The Colosseum was a magnificent edifice in the ancient world. And if you haven't seen the movie Gladiator, that's its name, Gladiator, I would recommend it just to see how they reconstructed the Colosseum. It really gives over an impressive vibe of what Rome was like at its height. So now, the Colosseum, our the Colosseum was used, of course, for sport. We know that many Jews were brought in there as gladiators as well. The Jewish community, I mean, of Rome, really originally was slaves who were sold and brought into Rome and bought their freedom and stayed there for a couple thousand years. But I want to share with you a very interesting discovery, which was made not even 20 years ago. So the Colosseum itself, this is a picture from the movie. Well, I think it's from a different movie, but it shows you the Colosseum. It's quite impressive. Okay. Other pictures of the Colosseum. So now there's this plaque that is in the Colosseum. Okay. And this plaque has a Latin dedication on it written in, I think it was from the 16th century. I think it's much later. It's been renovated several times. Sorry, not 16th, from like the 6th century. This is much later. What I want you to pay attention to is the little dots, those tiny little holes. Tiny holes. I'm going to clean it up for you so you can see it in a moment. But there used to be an older plaque before the stone was remodeled and recarved and etched with a new dedication from a later emperor who renovated it. The original plaque was much fancier. It was made with with metal letters. And imagine, for example, the letter A, and then I'll take us to the next piece. The letter A, for example, if you were to draw an A, but instead of drawing it to use a piece of metal, right? The way you would make the holes is one hole here, and one hole here. And that would hold in an A. Now, you can play this game, but you really got to know the Latin alphabet, and you have to know the way in which the Romans would write dedications with all kinds of abbreviations and so on. If you know that, you can start figuring out what could have possibly been written on the original plaque. And that takes us to this incredible study, which is an article online. You can find it on a Biblical Archaeology Review. I can send it to you later. I'm happy to send it to the rabbi. You can send it out if that's of interest. It's called Financing the Colosseum. Financing the Colosseum. So this is what it looks like today. But the reconstruction is just looking at those holes. You clean off all the letters. You see this? This is just the dots. And then you put it back together, these ghost letters. And there's a whole discussion about this, but at the end of the day, this is the result. And I left the text from the original article below, so you can see. It's a dedication attributing the construction of the Colosseum to Titus, but it explains that it was done with the proceeds from the spoils of war. And the article goes into what ex manubis means and what it means. But this is Louis Feldman. I think it's from 2007. This article, it's a great article. This is an incredible story, okay? Now, I'm going to take us from here. This is to the last part, and we're going to go to the Arch of Titus, okay? We'll get back to these coins momentarily. So we're almost done. From the Arch of Titus, we're going to continue down what's known as the Via Sacra to the Arch of, from the Colosseum to the Arch of Titus. The Arch of Titus, built by Titus in order to commemorate the destruction of the temple. Let me try to get a better view of it. Let's see, this should be a better view. Kind of a hit or miss, but we should be okay. Okay, here we go. So the Arch of Titus, which was built a few years after the destruction, after the parade it commemorates, is a notorious sign of our defeat. It's a symbol of the humiliation of the Jewish people, and the Jews of Rome and throughout history hated it. Only in 1948 did the attitudes toward it change, and I'll get to that in a moment. On the one side, this is a carving of Titus on his four chariot horses, quadriga, with the goddess Nike, the goddess of victory on top of him. And on the other side here is an image of the famous image of the Jews marching into being paraded with the temple vessels. It's one last chance at taking a look at it, and then we'll look at other stuff. There it is. And the menorah, right there. That's the menorah. Now, there's some misnomers from history that people thought it's the Jews carrying it, but it was covered in dirt. It was so hard to see. You could see anything you want in there. After it's been cleaned up, we know it's Roman soldiers. And here's where I'd like to wrap up our tour. So the Arch of Titus uses the destruction of the temple to glorify the Roman Empire, but also to humiliate the Jewish people. That is part of a line of artifacts which had to do with propaganda. The Emperor Vespasian, on this coin on the left, this is a gold denarii or sesterii. This is the very famous Judaea Capta coin. Look at this on the right. There is on the left a Roman soldier with his armor. On the right is a weeping woman underneath a palm tree. The palm tree represented Judea, and the woman is Jerusalem. Judea Capta, Judea Capta is Jerusalem is captured. This is a special coin which was spread throughout the empire, commemorating the destruction of the temple. That's how much it was a big deal. Let me show you a few other pictures to make this clearer. So here's another one. This one is in the Metropolitan Museum of Art. This one is a silver tetradrachma, four denarii. And this is a picture from the State of Israel, where we look at the symbol which was taken from the Arch of Titus, making the emblem, along with the Judea Capta. And then that's year 70, and this is 1948. And this takes us to the final part of our tour. When we talk about the impact of the Roman Empire not only on Jewish history, but on modern Israeli society, the awareness of the archaeology and the destruction and the propaganda made by Vespasian and Titus, and flipping that around consciously to turn that into symbols of our rebuilding. So I want to the first example I gave is the Judea Capta coin, and I mentioned the menorah from the Arch of Titus. Let's put these two together. On the top, we have a Judea Capta coin. The Society for Israeli Coins and Medals, the Numismatic and Metal Society, has designed a very special emblem. I think this was made in the 60s, or maybe 58 and then 60. There's a few of them which take that coin, but they flip it around. So on the bottom right, it says Yehuda HaMeshuchreret in Hebrew, and the woman is getting up and breaking her chains and chasing the soldier away. My favorite is the one on the left, which instead of showing a Roman soldier, it shows a pioneer planting a tree and a woman holding up a baby underneath the palm tree. And that is the Israel Liberata coin. It says it on the bottom, Israel liberated 1948, Israel HaMeshuchreret Tashach. This is an example of how we used that and flipped it around. And I'm sure you've heard of the poet Chaim Nachman Bialik. In Bialik's house in Tel Aviv, it's a beautiful house with a lot of custom-made designs, including ceramics. So downstairs, I took this picture myself. In the ceramics is a picture of the Judea Capta coin, and on the other side, the Yehuda Meshuchreret coin, which we just saw here. So he put that in his house. Last but not least, the Arch of Titus. In an exhibition called Arch of Titus in Color or True Colors, there's a lot of different, an article called True Colors. This is an exhibition in the Center for Jewish History in New York, based on a study done by Yeshiva University. I think it was 2013, 15, this was published in 2018. I might be getting the years off, but the article is from 2018. Stephen Fine, was an expert also in the Roman world, but also a world authority on the topic of the menorah, and my professor, he knew that statues in the Roman world were in color. As I mentioned, that's a current exhibit in the Metropolitan Museum of Art called Chrome. And based on this scholarly studies of color in the Roman world, they said, what could possibly be the colors that the Arch of Titus would have been painted in, because it was obviously painted? And this is an educated guess. It's just an educated guess. And if it were painted like this, it was the day it was painted, not a day later, because wear and tear, and it wouldn't look that pristine. But they did come in with special equipment and scanners, and they scanned the menorah, and they were able to find traces of the yellow paint. They found traces of the yellow paint. That is incredible. So that kind of proves that, and it became an exhibit. There's a whole story about it. However, what I want to point out is that the state of Israel deliberately chose the symbol which was there to parade our humiliation, and it was there for a couple thousand years, and they flipped it over to be the symbol of our rebuilding, even though there were many objections to this being the symbol, but it became the emblem of the state of Israel, taking the Roman Empire's attempt to make propaganda about the destruction of the temple in Jerusalem and the subjugation of our people, and switching it around to be a symbol of our rebuilding and redemption. That is, in a nutshell, our story of Jewish identity and Jewish history and its connection with Rome. There's, of course, a lot more to talk about. We didn't even talk about Bar Kokhba, but I think this gives us a good foundation for being able to talk about Rome and Jerusalem, which can be built on later. Well, thank you very much. I'm going to stop sharing here, but we're going to open the floor for questions and comments.
Thank you so much, Nachliel. That was incredible. And we thank you for today's presentation and for now all three of your presentations. We do have some time for questions. If you'd like to put them in the chat bar, or if you'd like to unmute yourself, please feel free to ask any question that you wish. While you're writing away, I'll tell you what comes into my mind. And I will just share with you that something that jumps out at me, and it was the last 5 minutes, is that Am Yisrael Chai, that the Jewish people lives. We have been looking at ancient Egypt, you know, every single year in the most important night of the year. We sit down around the table and we tell our children and grandchildren that we were slaves to Pharaoh in Egypt and God set us free. And we tell our kids we were slaves in Egypt and now we're free. We've looked at Mesopotamia, where Abraham came from, and now Rome. And when you see the destruction of the temple, when you see and hear and learn about what it means to have lost everything, in that last few slides, Nachliel, it was a genius move to look at the modern state of Israel's coins to say that we are once again alive and we're thriving in our country, in our homeland. It is, it's real. And it comes to life, and you realize that these great, mighty empires rose up against us. And like we say in the Haggadah, in every generation, they rose up to destroy us. And Hashem saved us from their hands. We are still here. We are still learning the story of our people, engaged in its history, and more importantly, engaged in our future. I'd like to take this opportunity to thank Nachliel Sullivan. I have a feeling this is not the last you have seen or heard of him. The feedback to me personally has been incredible. I want to say that publicly again. I opened with this. Nachliel, I want to close with this. I've received multiple emails, many, many emails, saying, why is this only a three-part series? People have been extremely happy. And I have a feeling, please God, we will yet see you again and our paths will yet cross again.
I have a question for Nachliel. At near the end of your lecture, you ended up showing a famous painting. I think it's in the London Museum, but you made no comment about it. It was with Jews falling over the side of a high stone. Can you explain why you brought that? Because you didn't make any comment.
The truth is here. Let me go back to that painting just so I can, so everybody hears what you're talking about.
I wasn't sure if it was a Rembrandt, if it was it's a famous artist from.
I'm looking for it. Hang on. I'm gonna try to find it. One second. Ah, here it is. Okay. I'll find it and I'll share the screen so everyone can see it. sec. Where is the share screen? Yeah, this painting.
Yeah, the truth, that's a famous painting.
It's a famous painting. I forgot who made the painting right now. I wasn't going to focus on the painting. I was just using this as a transition to talk about destruction. And it completely slipped my mind because I saw that we're kind of, I already was conscious of the times. So I'm like, you know what? I'm just going to mention we're switching to destruction. And I forgot about talking about this.
I'm not sure. It might be Rembrandt, and it might be in the London Museum.
I don't believe it's a Rembrandt. There are two famous paintings of the sacking of Jerusalem by Nicolas Poussin. It's not this one. One is in the Israel Museum and one is in, I think it's in Amsterdam.
Maybe Amsterdam because it was, right.
It's a very famous painting. When you come to the Israel Museum, I'm happy to show, to tell you about it. It's an incredible story, but that's for another time. Forgive me for not pausing to discuss the painting.
I have to go back and look at my notes. Rabbi Meir Soloveitchik in New York City from the Spanish synagogue there had a series of lectures, and that painting came up at one point, and I do not remember. He was juxtaposing it against another, and I don't know if it was Poussin's or somebody else's. And he pointed out some historical anomalies that were not accurate in the painting.
I mean, I'll be there this week. I might be able to hit him to speak to him. We'll see. I see. Vivian asked the $1 million question. What happened to the menorah is in the caves of the Vatican? So I want to say one thing. Until the 1950s, no Jew in their right mind would have thought that it's in the Vatican. It's sort of a PR thing that came up, and sort of the myth turned into a reality, and people believe it to be in the Vatican. Stephen Fine, in his book about the menorah, one of several books, actually wrote an article. I'm happy to send it again. If there's going to be a follow-up email with resources, I'm happy to put something together a little bit later. But basically, the menorah was probably looted when Rome was taken over by the Visigoths, taken over, melted down, destroyed. If you're wearing golden jewelry, there's a chance that you're wearing part of it. The Vatican, had they known where the menorah is, they would most likely publish it. They've published a tremendous amount of information to the public. The only reason we have so many manuscripts today are because of the Vatican, thanks to the Vatican. I wouldn't say the only reason, but the Vatican has been instrumental in publishing very rare Jewish manuscripts. They have no interest in hiding the menorah, nor do I believe that the building which ended up becoming the Vatican had anything to do with the Roman Empire when it was there. That's in a nutshell. Unfortunately, those who know the history and hear public figures saying to the Vatican, we'd like the menorah back, they just go, oh my gosh, this is just so embarrassing. So I hope, this is not the topic for today's conversation, but I can send resources about that as well. But the menorah has probably been stolen, melted down. There were probably several of them. It's a longer story.
And it's interesting, you made mention of the Vatican. When I was studying in Israel in the Sifri Alumi, we used to, for one of the Talmud professors, I had to compare manuscripts of various versions of the Talmud, and one was called the Vatican, like in the Vatican manuscripts. They had photocopies of it in the Sifri Alumi. I don't know what they still have. This is a long time ago. And we had to compare and write down any differences, and we used different coloring for each manuscript to show the differences.
Yes, Ktav Yad Vatican, there's Ktav Yad Roma. There's also the Meiri, who is a medieval scholar, who has a parish on the Talmud. I want to just
see. I see that Susan questions. Has her hand up. She's been waiting patiently.
Yes. Yeah, I'll talk very quickly. We went to Israel. We climbed by foot Masada. We went to the top. We were given a guided tour, and there was never a mention of the part that the Romans played. Never. I just heard it today for the first time in my life. But I have to admit, I grew up in Saskatchewan and didn't go to Jewish school. So maybe it would have been covered then. but I never knew about the Roman part in it.
Oh, there are people who go to Masada and don't even have any interest on climbing to the top. They study the stone bases of the foundations of the Roman camps that were outside it, because they found letters there with like, what is the Roman salary? I mean, there's all kinds of interesting things that were found out there, and what happened on top is of lesser interest to them. Yeah.
That's amazing. Anyway, thank you very much.
Our pleasure. The painting is by Francesco Hayes. So thank you very much, Franz.
Okay.
For posting that.
And I would love more classes like this.
Thank you.
Would love it. Yeah,
we're happy to discuss.
Susan, you're in good company. So many people feel the same way. Nathalie, let me once again thank you. You've been incredible. Yes.
Yeah, thank you.
This class has been recorded. We will be sending it out to you. So if you wish to watch it again and review it, you can watch this again as we will get this video up on YouTube. I'd like to thank Nathalie once more. And to everybody, I just want to finish by saying this Wednesday night, I will be continuing with tomorrow, Tuesday lunchtime, I will be continuing the fourth of my series, The Content of Their Character, where we have been looking at the themes of honesty, integrity, and lies. And we'll be wrapping up tomorrow's class with a very controversial topic of when it's a mitzvah to change the truth. That's tomorrow at 12. And on Wednesday night, 7 p.m., I will be giving an in-person class here at the Shah Shamayim. If this background looks different to you than my regular background, it's because I'm speaking to you right now from inside the Shah, as I'm here with you in Montreal. And Wednesday night at 7, I'll be giving a class on Cain and Abel and violence in Judaism. Looking forward to seeing you in person. And Nachliel, thank you so much for an amazing three-part series.